Welcome to Out of the Blue, a podcast about all the great things that are coming out of the Delft University of Technology, specifically industrial design and engineering. And today we're talking to Professor of Practice, Jeroen van Erp, Professor of Concept Design. And what is concept design, Jeroen?
It's all about ideas, ideation, how we call it in this faculty, about generating ideas and concepts that go beyond the ordinary.
Yeah, and when I think of concept design, I sort of think, okay, let's put a brainstorming and let's put some methods and tools for that. So is that what you're specialized in?
No. It's much more than that. I think I'm specialized in judging the concepts if they're good enough.
Yeah.
And I think it's a bit the reason why my inaugural lecture was about this is that I think it's a bit underestimated how important the idea itself is, the quality of the idea.
Yeah.
And I think that there is no method, no process, no model how to develop a good idea.
No, it's about the spark.
It's about the spark, it's about creativity. You can judge an idea, but to get to the idea, it's not a peef-puff-poof process. And a lot of our students find it very, very, very difficult. Developing good ideas, you can train it. For instance, people in advertising, they're trained in developing good ideas by making it very hard for them. So I have very good friend of mine, Matthijs Goos. He's a very renowned advertising guy, he developed really great concepts, and he was trained by during his apprenticeship by the guy who mentored him. And he said, okay, you can't leave the studio before you have 20 new ideas for this problem.
Yeah.
So he was forced to come up with new ideas to explore his mind, to to challenge himself.
And we tend to stop at 3 or 5.
No, we tend to stop. We think we do a brainstorm, and at the end of the day, we collect the ideas and think we have. And it's really interesting that I wrote a blog about this in Dutch about brainstorming because I hate the fact that people think it's the Holy Grail, and it's astonishing that after a day brainstorming. Mm-hmm. Everybody thinks the idea is there. And it never occurs to people that maybe it was all not good enough. So we have to do it all over again. And maybe not a day, but a week or 2 weeks.
Yeah. Yeah, so I know students who are, especially in their graduation, they're sort of waiting for the spark.
Yeah.
And then they...
Like waiting on the bus.
That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and just, I think normally, I think they walk away just before the bus arrives, right?
Yeah, but what I like, you know, we have I'm a teacher for PO3.
Yeah.
Design course in the second year.
Yeah.
And last year we did a test with explaining the course by doing it in 1 hour, in 1 day, and 1 week.
Yeah, yeah.
And that really the astonishing conclusion is that the results in the 1 hour course are not really not worse than the 1 week course.
Yeah.
I mean, so it's
yeah, so the and ideas when they are very young, they're still very fragile, but by doing it in an hour, they make it sort of
But if you do it in an hour, you're open, you know, you can not be distracted by all kind of requirements or there's no weight that
Because that's
in the wrong direction.
That's the other thing. Students have the tendency to sort of analyze very well, nice reports, nice research, and then they start designing, and I have the same thing as well. Then it sort of it takes away the way you can sort of every drawing you make, you think, oh, but that requirement, that part, I still have to worry about that part.
Yeah.
So that's a problem, that it sort of stifles your expression when you know too much.
Yeah, no, but I know. I think the knowing is okay, but you have to. You know, it's like it's you have to find a balance between the knowing and the analyzing, and then at a certain moment feeling free to come up with solutions that maybe conflict with what you know, but letting them go. So it's a it can be trained easily, but you have to put attention to it.
And so I know you. So if I talk to students, they describe you as one of those inspirational students that really gets their passion out. You've been here for 4 years now, and how has those? So you're the other thing is in the beginning you talked about professor of practice, but you're actually a professor from practice, isn't it?
Yeah. I didn't follow the classic route of becoming getting a PhD, become an assistant professor, associate professor, and a full professor. Mm-hmm. So I came from practice. So I founded the Fabriek agency in '92, and what the theory behind professors of practice is that if you follow the classic route, you write. I mean, you have publications and papers and journal papers and mm-hmm. books and whatever. And in the Faculty of Architecture, they always say that their designs are also publications, which I think is very nice.
Yeah.
So, and I think because publications are always, or designs are always very well reasoned and they're criticized, so it's. It follows a kind of the same process, and I think that's a nice approach.
Yeah. So the things that you've done in practice, you would call them publications as well.
Yeah. Why not?
Yeah. And then so one of the big things that you're doing right now is trying to change the education here as well.
Yeah. One of the reasons to appoint professors from practice is to involve them in the development of the new bachelor. So I was, I think the project started 2017, and among others, Jos Oberdorf was involved, and also Deborah. And we started working on a manifesto, and then principles about how to make this manifesto tangible in curriculum. And unfortunately, due to the COVID-19 crisis, the introduction of the bachelor is 1 year postponed. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, we would have had it in September. So it's September 2021 it will be introduced. But I think it's a extremely interesting project, because what we did is we teared down the house. You know, mm-hmm. for 50 years the bachelor was built and extended, and it's like a house, you know, with a new rooftop and new towers and new things in the garden and extended this.
And most of the innovations came from research, which is very interesting, but they came from the basically research, master, and then bachelor.
Yeah, it's not a top-down process. So here we did a kind of VIP light approach. So we imagined what kind of designer does the world need in 2030? Mm-hmm. And we reasoned back to, okay, then we have to develop a curriculum which is like it is what we imagined. And that really worked very well. And it so we had a quite high ambition. Yeah. And I'm very proud that the curriculum, as we envisioned it now, it still matches this high ambition. So that's very nice.
And so what was the spark in sort of developing the curriculum? What sort of, where did you find that good idea?
I think three or four pivotal insights or moments. I think we put a lot of effort in describing the domain of the designer.
Yeah.
And it's the three-layered model. I think some we will show a picture.
Oh, we can show the sort of... Yeah.
It's a three-layered model where we see, okay, what are the roots of design?
Yeah.
What is happening now in design world regarding product service systems? And we're heading towards a world where the designer can play a role in developing more complex smart product service systems. And I think that's a canvas which is extremely interesting, which puts everything in place, but also... It looks very technical, but it's it gives a lot of inspiration. So that was one. And the other one is, I think, still the manifesto we wrote in 2017 is still very valid, also in this crisis.
No.
If you read it and with what's happening now in mind, I think it's still very good. And the other one is we also developed a canvas to frame assignments. And that really helps to give direction to the design projects we want to give in the 3 year of the bachelor.
Yeah.
And these are, this was really an effort of a lot of people joining and
Yeah, and then, so this changes, so that manifesto and sort of the way you see designers, does that, is that purely for education, or do you see that in research coming back as well, or?
Of course, the faculty has a really good position as it comes to research.
Yeah.
It, which is completely underestimated by the outside world. Designers in the Netherlands, even in my company, haven't got a clue what researchers are doing here and how good they are. And that has two sides. It is because a designer doesn't read, is not interested in research. He's interested in
result.
And in himself,
oh.
herself. And the other thing is that the researchers don't reach out to the designers.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's something which is... I mean, that it can be improved, let's put it like that.
Yeah.
But our research position, capabilities, and what we have is, of course, also incorporated in the curriculum.
Yeah.
I think much better than it was, and that's really good. What was your question?
Yeah, so does it sort of did it fan out? I mean, so then you sort of in education you say this is a manifesto. This is what we want researchers, designers to be. But now does that also influence research and?
Now, what the nice thing is that as a professor, I'm involved in this these talks and these. Conversations about direction of the faculty and so on. And what you see is that the bachelor project and the insights we developed is really contributing to a much more articulated position of the faculty, while all the movements that went on to define a new position of the faculty were a bit tensed and so, and you see this bottom-up approach really helped to articulate, and that's really good. And I think there is also a kind of a extended effect of the ideas about this new bachelor. If you look at them, then it's also inspires maybe new directions for the master. So it resonates with each other, and I think that's really nice. And I'm especially also proud because when we started with this new bachelor, there were people at this faculty looking at me and they said, don't get involved. I mean,
it's a swamp.
It's one big booby trap, you know. In Dutch, kansloos.
Yeah, won't know. We'll never see you back. Because I think it's interesting. One of the sort of the real ideas about the new bachelor is that the relationship as a so currently, I mean, in current practice, you are the designer, and then there's a client, and you work for the designer, and you're sort of changing that in the new bachelor. And from research, I could sort of think of that, but from practice, it's kind of scary, right?
No. I think what is good is that there are more lenses. We have more lenses to the real world, and that's good. I mean, there is the lens, the autonomous lens. I would like to do good for the world, and
so I want to design something.
I want to design something. There is this lens, how can I help companies? There is this lens, how I can governmental institute. And I think these multiple lens approach, that's really good, because then students realize the world of design. Then they start understanding design. What you hear a lot from students is that when they start their apprenticeship at a company, and they come back and say, now I understand what it's all about, you know. Yeah. So I think it would be it's really good to give them a better understanding of what design is, what design can do, what kind of flavors there are in the world, and so they can choose their own path, which is, I think, very important.
Yeah, and so this brings me to your you mentioned it in the beginning, your inaugural lecture.
Yeah,
that was 4 years ago.
Yeah,
11 November 2016, yeah. Together with the other professors of practice.
Yeah,
and now your book is out.
Yeah,
and it's called Is It Good Enough? But it looks quite good. So how did that happen?
Yeah. The first time I was really inspired by an inaugural lecture was by Paul Meixner, former professor over here. Paul Meixner, the guy who designed the Schiphol wayfinding system.
Yes.
And he was a mentor for my graduation, and I worked with him for designing the wayfinding system for Dutch Railways.
He was my graduation professor as well.
Good. Yeah. I still have very good contact with him. I also send him the book. Now, the thing is, he gave a kind of a multimedia show, and it was somewhere in the 90s, and I was flabbergasted. It was completely new. And he came with a very nice book about his talk. And when I later on saw other inaugural lectures, I found them very boring, you know.
Yeah.
Bad slides, ugly typography, not well prepared. And then afterwards, the new professors came out with a very ugly book in a standard TU Delft format, not attractive at all. And I'm so annoyed by this. So I thought, if I publish my inaugural lecture, it will be looking damn good. That was my ambition. And so I worked together with a really nice, very talented and well-experienced designer, Frans Lieshout. And we started working with it somewhere in the summer of last year, because then I found time. So it was step by step, we took it further. And I had to rebuild my lecture because I had eight little movies in my lecture, and they communicate a lot of stuff, which is not... it's different if you write it on paper. So I had to rework it a little bit and then put it out. And I found Lectures, which is a very renowned publisher. They really wanted to put this out. So that's how we did.
Very nice. So looking at the insides, it almost reads like a multimedia show because it has sort of in zoomy pictures and RGB things happening. But it also there's not that much design in it. There's some cooking in it. There's pop music. There's roads.
Yeah.
Civil engineering.
Yeah, a few things. I tried to stay away from making it a commercial break for my own work.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought developing good ideas is means independent. You know, it's a cook has to develop a good idea about a meal. An architect, a landscape architect, a songwriter. So it's all about it's finding this tipping point where you think, okay, now I have an idea that is good enough. So, and I think that's the quality I was looking for. So I was really looking for ideas from other sectors and other disciplines. So you better understand what it's all about. So you're not distracted from things that doesn't matter at that moment.
Yeah. So then, if you sort of dive deeper into what you talked about, it is you talked about, for example, Bojan Slot.
Yes.
And how do you think sort of his so how did that work with him? So so please explain what he did.
Okay. And then little rewind. I was one of the directors, program directors of TEDx Delft. And I got a call, I think it was 2012, from Rob Spekenbrink. He was the licensee holder of TEDx. And he said, please talk to this guy. He's an aerospace student, and he has a funny idea of fishing all the plastic from the ocean. And so I made an appointment with him, and I had a chat with him. And I he had an answer to all my questions. So he said, okay, I want to do it like this. And he already had a vision about what to do with the plastic. He had already a vision how to find it. He knew what people to involve. And he so it was well thought of in many aspects. And he had a drive. And the only thing he didn't have were good visuals about his plan. So with Erwin, a guy from Fabriek, we helped him to develop the visions and the visuals. And the rest is history. Yeah. So his core idea was brilliant, and it was also very relevant, and it immediately also didn't only touch the mind but also the heart. So it was so when he was on stage, something really happened.
Yeah, and so there were your visuals. I mean, not your, but
no, from Brink. Now, but it was especially recognizing the. I think my contribution was recognizing the fact that.
This was a good idea.
That this was a good idea.
Yeah.
And he himself also was convinced.
And it's not just like that the guy is a good guy. Is that is or is
he's, is a very, is he, he's a very good guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No. What's more important?
No, the interesting thing, Janos, and that's really interesting. When he was in front of me, you know what I thought?
No.
I thought, you're the singer of the band.
Ah, yeah.
If he was born 40 years ago, he would have started the band to speak out to the world, and he would have been the singer.
Yeah, no, but so sometimes everybody says it's not about the idea; it's about the team, or it's about stuff like that. But
he's a guy with leadership.
Yeah,
but that's a different podcast.
Okay, wonderful. All right, I think this brings us to the tips.
Already?
Yeah, unless there's... Do we need to... Is there a topic that we haven't talked about?
We can talk for hours.
I know.
Yeah.
And we've talked about inside, outside. We talked about advertising as a good... but so let's... So we finished this podcast with tips that the audience can do.
Yeah.
So do you have a tip for our audience?
Okay. I have two tips.
Sure.
First tip is for all the students in Delft.
Yeah.
Jump on the bike.
Jump on the bike.
Make a reservation at Museum Voorlinden in Wassenaar.
Yeah.
Which is amazing. And visiting museums in this period of time, where there is a limited audience allowed, is really nice. You have a lot of art for yourself. And I think Museum Voorlinden is...
it's a total experience, right?
It's a total experience. It's one of the best museums we have at this moment, which is amazing because of the fact that it's a private museum, so not like the Stedelijk. And it's, to be honest, in my opinion, better than the Stedelijk at this moment.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And the other tip...
It's quite accessible, right?
Because quite accessible.
And I mean, mentally, sort of, I understand every art piece that is in there.
No, that it's accessible, but not superficial.
Yeah, and without explaining.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, nice. And a lot of eye candy. Hey, and that's what our students like.
Sure.
Eye candy. And the other thing is, I'm a music lover, as you might know, and I'm a big fan of Jules Holland, BBC Two, Friday evening. His show is called Later, and he used to invite different bands or singer-songwriters in one studio, and one by one they play a song. And now they made a pivot towards an online show, so he talks online with one artist, and they harvest tracks from the archive. And all these artists are artists he knows very well, and he's a stunningly good piano player. So he has very intimate conversations with them, and it's really nice. Friday evening, I think it's called Later, and I think it's 11 o'clock UK time, so 12 o'clock our time, or the other way around. No,
and maybe if you have access to BBC. Online, you can.
Yeah, there are some. You can hack. You can hack the.
The VPN.
Hack, yeah, the VPN.
Routes,
yeah, sure. But it's.
It's worth it.
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah, those are two tips.
Do you have a tip, Janus? Do you have a tip?
Of course I do. I have it every time. And I wanted to... So we've been doing all these meetings online now because we're at home. And I think that has changed our idea a lot. And we've first been amazed by the fact that we can do work remotely, that we're able to do it. But now, I mean, we will keep on doing parts of that, and even if things get different again. But what I want to challenge the audience is to think about sort of after you have first put your laptop a little bit higher so that we're not looking into your nose, after you've put on the light in front of you instead of...
You can trim your nose...
Nose hairs, right? But I bought on AliExpress a very cheap little thing, which is a ring LED.
Janus, what is cheap?
Yeah, €3.
That's very cheap.
They're very cheap. Yeah. It's too cheap, actually. Yeah. But the nice thing is, that if it's at night, it still radiates on your face so that people can see you. But the nice attribute of that as well is that you are realizing that the camera is in the middle of that ring so that you're not watching sort of the ground while you talk to us. Because we are becoming more like autistic people looking at the ground when we need to talk to each other. There's a lot of Zoom conversations where people are looking at documents while they're actually...
I sense some self-reflection, Janus.
Yeah, I'm totally guilty of that.
Yeah.
So I'm challenging all of us to sort of get better at this.
Yeah.
Not all the time.
Okay.
I mean, you can be bad sometimes and good on other times.
Okay.
And the other thing is, I've also brought sort of a piece of green cardboard. Very simple. You can buy it everywhere. And the great thing about this is anything can be in here if you use one of those green screen functions. And it's quite magical to sort of wave that around when you... So instead of having like a pure green screen behind you, you can play around with the fact that you have a slide that is sort of hidden somewhere. So I think there are opportunities. You can even cut this paper in different shapes. So it's very powerful. And I think we haven't explored the medium of Zoom or Skype or all these other tools yet. So that's what that's my tip. I want to see some exciting things happening.
Thank you very much, Janus. Very useful.
All right. With that, we are at the end of I hope our technician, Geraldo, does something with, if you're watching it online, with the green screen. He sort of puts funny pictures in there. So then we can change this and it becomes a different reality. Because at the end, I also want to thank Geraldo Solisa, our technical producer, and our producer for content, Mark, the goal. I want to thank you for talking to us.
I want to thank you, Janus.
Wonderful. Yeah. Had a great time, and we hope to see you next time later.
Stay safe.
Stay safe and well, yeah. All right.
Woohoo. Mana mana do do to do do. Mana mana do 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 to. Mana mana do do to do do to do do to do do to do 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 do